is Kanish. Welcome to my channel. Today I've got a very special guest. His name is Mr. Hari Shuddhikumar. He's a BTech Triple E student at BITS Goa. He's working on two very interesting ideas. One of them is called Plenify. It's a community with students of different colleges engaged. Consider checking it out. The link will be in the description. And in this podcast, we had a lot of in-depth discussion about the entrepreneurship circle in India and how the ecosystem is bursting out, how things are falling in place, what do the VCs think, what do the entrepreneurs think. Consider checking it out. Hang in there and hope you have a nice day. Thank you.
Hi Arish, how are you?
I'm good, Kanishk. Thanks for having me. How are you?
I'm fine. So welcome to the podcast. We'll start with the questions. My first question to you is I've been seeing too many how life of a student in BITS Goa, life of a student in IIT Delhi right now, since you've started this trend, I guess, I don't know. And strangely enough, I found you not through BITS Goa videos. I found you through, I was reading this book called Strive to Unlock, and I was reading the review of this book and I found you through that. So I found your blog content very fascinating. So I just wanted to explore, and then I found this is a good guy, I can call him, and relevant enough for my audience. So I guess, my question to you is, as I said, there are a lot of videos regarding this fact, like life of a BITS Goa student. So people are selling them as a BITS Goa student. They're not selling themselves as their own self, right? So the personal branding thing, which we talk a lot about these days in the entrepreneurship circle, is getting lost because of this big brands coming into picture. So do you think, what has Curious Harish did different than any other guy in BITS Goa, or maybe any other college, who started their own brand, and what was your hacks? Like, could you tell us about them?
Okay. First of all, different people have different ways of running a channel. So, I wouldn't say that Harish is doing something differently. Everyone else is following the same path. Everyone, pretty much every person who puts out content has their own strategy, has their own ways of making videos. And you said, affiliating your videos with BITS Goa. And I did that in the beginning when I was making videos. Every title used to have BITS Goa so that people search for it and click on my videos, and worked pretty much, right? Every time, before Jan 2020, when I used to post videos, it rarely crossed 200 views. But the moment I started putting in BITS Goa in the title, they crossed like 10,000 views every single time I uploaded a new video. But then soon that started getting saturated, right? People weren't, like, views weren't crossing 10,000 so soon, even if I put the word BITS Goa. And that's the thing, right? If you make clickbait videos based on a certain aspect, then it might do well for some time, it might give you a kickstart, but then eventually you have to be innovative because the audience is just bored of consuming the same type of content again. And that's when I shifted to something more broad, something more, something that suits a larger audience. If I made videos about just BITS Goa, I would have just served the 12th grade students who want to get into BITS through BITSAT. And that's a very small demographic, right? People who want to get into BITS Goa in their 12th grade. Right now, I make videos about college life in general, which is a much, much larger, audience base. And when I started making college videos, I used to just share things that are happening in my life, and things like every single day is different. So I can make a different video every single day. And that gave me a lot of, time to document my life, a lot of time to think about new ideas and make more videos. So yeah, that's been working out pretty well. I've been able to serve a larger audience. Yeah.
The thing is, I liked your videos because they weren't vlogs and they weren't blogs. They were something in the between. They were you were telling about things, sitting in your room, and you were showing them, I'm doing my class right now, I'm doing this. They weren't blogs, and they were a completely different niche, something in the middle, something very new. So I kind of liked it. So what is your strategy to get through YouTube, right? Not just making good content, high definition content, or maybe good content which has like good things in it, or maybe just a mix of both. What do you prefer?
Mix of both. Be consistent and be yourself. So it doesn't matter if you're someone who's really messy, if you're someone who doesn't like to put in a lot of efforts and just film yourself sitting in a room, that's totally fine. Or if you're someone who likes to put in high production, even that's totally fine. But you just have to be consistent. That's the secret to YouTube.
Sure. So the next thing, how are you holding up in the lockdown right now?
In all honesty, lockdown has been pretty good. Because of online college, I've been able to, do a lot of things that I wouldn't have otherwise, learning to code, meeting a lot of cool, folks from the VC circle. It's pretty fun. So, have been building a lot of stuff.
I guess you're the first one to say this to me right now, because everyone is currently more into going back to college and going back to hostel because they consider coding as a group activity, not something you learn on your own. So I don't know, just something like that. So how do you think this, like earlier when I was in class 12, you might be in class 12. So we had a dream like in class, could classes come to our own quilt in the winter mornings? So, and this thing actually turned into reality right now. Classes have come to, so certain things we didn't even imagine in class 11th and 12th could happen are happening right now. And we weren't quite ready for this shift. That was very drastic. So do you think COVID has acted as a catalyst towards like development? We weren't ready for it. Is it good to have it right now? Or should we have been given a head start for this? I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty cool to attend classes from your bed. I mean, I'm not someone who can comment on this because I rarely go for classes.
I mean, not just classes, everything in general. Fine. Like all the job, everything in circle. Like COVID has acted as a catalyst for everything.
Like that. Yeah, it has acted as a catalyst for unemployment also in that case.
Yeah, sure.
I don't know, it has both positive and negative aspects. But I think, you know, when you live a very monotonous life, things get very boring. Like even college, I do agree, it's really fun to hang out with your friends and go out there, play a sport. But the sudden shift to, you know, studying from home was also fun. The transition period was really fun. It was like dream life. But yeah, then things got monotonous again. And now people are like, hey, bahar jaake khelna hai. But yeah, I think there should be a balance of these switches. And hopefully we should get back to campus. But sure, yeah, I mean, obviously considering things like unemployment, it's a very negative thing that's happening. So the better we become normal and start transacting economically, the faster, you know, development will become.
Sure. But since you talked about unemployment right now, and I was seeing a Kunal Shah post, Twitter post the other, like 2 days ago. So he was talking about unemployment and this is being talked about a lot right now. And you talk about automation a lot in your videos. And I see you talk about AI, ML. So when we talk about AI, ML, yeah, it seems like a very like hunky-dory dream. Things could happen. We will not have to work for this. The computer will learn on its own. And you were connected to certain chatbots agency. You made our own chatbot portal for yourself. So does this automation hamper the growth of a country in a very larger picture? Or does it actually help a very small amount of people? So what's your take on that? And what's the,
So I'm not very well-versed with how AI is changing, you know, huge industries. But I can tell you what we were doing. We were trying to automate the customer support area, right? People, chat operators who just keep chatting with customers the entire day. We were trying to automate a certain part of it. And I don't think it's hampering jobs at all. We are just making their job easier. A lot of chat operators have to answer the same question again and again. Like, what's the price of X? A person asks that like 100 times a day, the chat agent has to type it 100 times a day. They were like, hey, why are you working so hard? Just do the complex parts and let the bot handle the easy parts. So it's just making things much more easier and efficient. It's automating the low skill tasks. At least that's what we are trying to do. Because we don't feel that humans should be doing low skill tasks. Humans are meant to be doing something much, much more complex. And I think that's what, the field we are working on is doing. In a broader sense, AI is changing a lot of things in healthcare, making, you know, identifying things like cancer much easier, but I'm not very well versed with those aspects of AI.
Sure. I guess you quoted the Sapiens. We are not meant for doing basic stuff. We are meant for doing complex stuff. So but I guess this particular fact, right, you said the customer support help is getting easier. But what about a CEO just opened up a startup? He wants a feedback agency of his own. Earlier, he used to hire like 2 or 3 people for the customer support thing. Now he just has to buy a subscription of your app. That's much cheaper. That hampers app. But that's a road to development also. That's a road to efficiency
exactly,
also.
Yeah. So that means the person has to get upskilled and get a better job.
Of course. And I guess the same thing happened when Netflix sold their database management system to AWS. Like this is the same thing that happened. Yeah, of course. My next question was, what is the secret of all this knowledge people have, like you have these days? Like you read, what do you read? What's the base of all this knowledge? Is it the YT Combinator videos? Y Combinator videos, or what is it?
First of all, I don't know a lot of things. I just, it's not even reading. It's just surfing on the internet and seeing what people are doing. I would say Twitter is a good place to be in. Reddit is a good place to be in. Reading a bunch of TechCrunch articles helps. And more or less, as you said, watching things like Y Combinator videos or Greylock partner videos, just good YouTube videos in general can teach you a lot. You know, following channels like Noah Kagan can teach you a lot. Then there are good podcasts like the one by Ranveer Alabadia.
Sure.
These are all good sources of inspiration, and your podcasts have like really changed the way I look at certain things, because I'm not a huge fan of reading. I mean, I do read books, but podcasts are a much easier way of consuming
content. What are you reading right now?
Right now I'm reading a book on venture capitalism.
It's called
Demystifying Venture Capitalism.
I had a conversation about that. Yeah, we'll have a conversation later. You talked about podcasts right now, right? So my question to you is, you also do a lot of podcasts, and you might have been in contact with people who do a lot of podcasts. And I guess like when you have a knowledge about something, like as a podcaster, you talk to a lot of people in depth about the topic, right? So when you tend to talk about so many people in depth about a certain topic, you get a lot of perspectives. Like this is wrong, this is right. You read Phil Knight's Shoe Dog. It's a completely different perspective. And you write Apoorv Chamaria's the best held startup secrets. It's a completely different story. So does so many perspectives hamper your own self? What the perspective you have of your business, of your product, or does it gives you an overall liberation regarding the fact that I have so many perspectives, I can build a better version of all of them. So how does it help in a bigger picture?
Yeah, I think it's the latter part, right? You know, just copying what someone else is saying isn't the best way of moving forward. Like if you read Kunal Shah's tweets and you're like, oh, that's the way I'm going to do it, that's how I'm going to lead my life, you there are high chances you're going to fail, because he's a person who has sold his company, has $91 million in his bank account. You're a person who's in college, different life scenarios, right? So not everything is applicable in your case. So I would say appreciate everyone's perspectives and then see what's applicable in your life. Like if you're watching David Dobrik's vlogs and if you're like, hey, I want to be like David Dobrik, I want to move to Los Angeles and make prank videos, then you wouldn't become David Dobrik. You have to, you know, carve your path.
Okay, you mean like we should innovate in the innovation, right? We should keep re-innovating. That's the key to it, pretty much. So yeah,
just
of
be original, just be yourself. Don't
of course,
fake
of course.
It.
Yeah, faking it, I'm copying it. It's like, I don't know. Let's move
like,
forward.
Like I hate
to
that
it.
Phrase. What's that called? Fake it till you make it.
Fake it till you make it. I guess it works for certain people. It works for a very small number of people.
I think it works for Instagram influencers.
Yeah, of course. So yeah, we'll come to Instagram after a while. My next question to you was, I've seen a lot of your videos and your videos only, and many other people who stress on this fact that you should we skip college? Like, if a person has a very good idea and not at all.
No, not at all. College. See, I've seen so many people, even on Shark Tank. I think there was a 17-year-old kid.
Yeah,
who was
selling
like,
bottles,
hey,
right?
My company. Yeah, I don't know who he was. Some Indian kid. And he was like, hey, if this company takes off, if I get investment, I'll not go to college. Mark Cuban, his net worth is $2 billion. He was like, no, a big, big no. You have to go to college. And I feel the same way, right? I know a lot of people say, hey, drop out of college. It's so cool. Follow your dreams, follow your passion. But I say, go to college. The amount of experiences, the amount of maturity you'll gain in college is just incredible, right? Because until school, you haven't been living in the real life. It's some fake artificial life that's just, you know, decorated by your parents and teachers. College will make you much, 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 much more mature. Those 4 years on campus will teach you a lot. You'll meet various kinds of people. You'll know how to tackle different situations. And that's like this incubation period for you to later on go and do something much better. So I feel 17 and all is too immature. Until you have a really crazy idea that's taking off, I would say just go to college. It'll help you a lot.
I guess depends on the context also a bit, because I see Nicholas White's videos, or maybe Tech with Tim. Sometimes they talk about like Nicholas White is a very great YouTuber, made all the lead Kodaks. So he talks about like, why have I spent like 4 years to 6 years in college and have so high education loans? But that's an American context. You can leave the college over there. It's acceptable in society. In India, I guess it's not. So yeah, of course. The next question is, if you do college, up to what extent should you do college? Because BTech is okay. Everyone does it. It's the next BSc in India, I guess. But after BTech, when you have to learn about business, there are many ways of it. Going into the school of life theory, like going to learn by your own experiences, failing multiple startups, maybe doing multiple internships at small places, being a part of many organizations and building your own organization. That's a way to go. Or maybe you should depend on that robust and maybe stereotypical structure of doing an MBA maybe, or maybe doing an MS, or maybe going to the US. And that gives you a whole different perspective, a whole different version of experience and exposure. So what do you think is the most trusted strategy of 20?
Doing an MBA is not going to equip you with the tools to go out there and start up. It might help you get a job at a bank. It might help you get into investment banking. It might help you get into the venture capital ecosystem. But obviously, no MBA is going to teach you how startups work, or it's a completely different thing, right? When you talk about business, I think you're talking about startups.
I'll just hold you one second. My question was like not MBA as a degree for education, MBA as a brand maybe, because an IIM Ahmedabad guy pass out is very highly likely to raise a capital of $1 million than a guy who's just started off like a 22 year old. So yeah, I also wanted to keep this in mind. So yeah, what's your take on that?
Yeah, the reason why the IIM A grad is able to raise money quickly is because of the network. And even if you're not from an IIM A grad, I know building network is really tough, and college does provide a huge you know, network along with the degree. For example, in BITS, the network is huge, and I'm really privileged to have access to it. And similar for some IITs and ITs, IIMs. Yeah, so the network obviously helps, but in terms of the general essence of a startup, which is to solve a major problem, it doesn't matter. You could be Ritesh Agarwal, who never went to college, but he's solving a huge problem, right? So in the general context of the startup, it doesn't matter. Raising capital, it might help you in the first round. Maybe it might help you in getting a $100,000 to $50,000 check in your seed round. But later on, everything is dependent on your milestones and how well you do, right? OYO is, I think, I think it's, I don't know, I think $5 billion maybe valuation. I'm not sure.
Yeah, of course.
But yeah, obviously SoftBank is not going to be like, oh, this guy's from BITS, this guy's from IIM. I'm going to invest $1 billion in them. That's not going to happen. So maybe initial days, yeah. But later on, I'm not sure. And most of these MBA grads, they just look for a very cushioned ecosystem. So yeah, people do get into the startup ecosystem, but they'll mostly work for a long period of time, have some financial backing, and then venture out.
Yeah, I guess solving a problem is the thing. If you talk about Ritesh Agarwal, he solved a very small problem of hospitality, of the ease. And Ayush Jaiswal, for example, the founder of, I don't remember the company's name. Pesto. He is training grads for getting high-end jobs. So he's solving a very complex problem of hiring these days in India. And he's solving a very basic problem. But both of them are getting equally successful. So I guess it's all about solving a problem these days. Of course, right?
The numbers would speak for themselves.
Of course. So yeah, I'm done with my questions. Like, what do you have to say for a guy who's currently in a not so great college, maybe who doesn't have access to the amount of network BITS provides, or maybe IITs provide? What should be his strategy, like through LinkedIn, or what should be his strategy? I'm not giving words.
Start hanging out with cool people. Start hanging out with smart people. You can join Clinify if you want. Also start meeting, start having podcasts with, you know, good people. And then another thing is attend conferences, attend, you know, these networking sessions. There's a website called f6s.com, which has a bunch of conferences happening. Attend these events, because that's where you can meet like CEOs, executive level people, which you would not otherwise meet. And LinkedIn, it might work, but a lot of people would not respond to your DM. So I would say the best way of reaching out to cool people is through conferences and things like that. But yeah, try cold emailing, try LinkedIn, and just be with smart people. Just have smart people around you.
And things will turn around eventually. Sure. That's for the podcast. How was the experience in this podcast? Like, what are the feedback for me for the next episode? How much should I fumble less?
No, I mean, it was good. It was good, bro.
Yeah, okay. So, I guess you might want to share this, like, share and subscribe. People don't usually do that to my channel.
I think you should. There are very few good podcasts out there, and he's doing an amazing job in doing that. So, just if you want to become smarter and richer, then subscribe to Kanishka's podcast.
Sure. Thanks a lot, Harish. Thank you for bearing with us currently. And thank you.